Rex Krueger is a professional woodworker. Rex Krueger thinks you own a full set of Forstner bits. And one of these things. And probably some crazy wooden hand plane. Is Rex Krueger out of touch with the common woodworker? Does he want to take away your power tools?
I love hand tools, obviously.
Today, we're going to watch a video by Rex Krueger. Rex Krueger is what some people would call a Neanderthal, which is a woodworker that doesn't like to use power tools. He likes to use mostly hand tools. What are you doing? Are you making fun of me? Thank you. That's awesome. You're so cool. Yeah. Let's watch the video. It's a Moravian stool.
I've built a couple of these Moravian stools, and it is a great project that most people are never going to try. And that's because of this sliding dovetail joint. It's really not that hard.
We're not going to do
Some
that.
Some folks are just intimidated. So we need a simpler, easier version that's better for beginners.
And actually, we're beginners?
Built that easier version.
I mean, I've been no doing this for 30 work, years, but...
No fancy joinery, but all the looks and class of the original. And the best part is, you can build it out of any old garbage wood.
Really?
The stuff I have here.
You know what? We have garbage wood.
It's old shelving in the trash.
Yay!
Someone covered it in wood grain contact paper, which is weird since this is, you know, actual wood and already has a wood grain. Whatever. This yellow pine is going to make a great piece. I'll cross cut my stock to length and then clean up the ends with my jack plane. The biggest piece in the project is the seat. So I picked a nice, clear section with no knots or defects. I'm lucky enough to have wide stock, but you can easily
make it. Okay, I've seen enough. Let's pause it. I think this would be a good video for us. You think we can do it?
I'm too tired for this.
Okay, sweetheart, you can go inside if you want to. You don't have to.
No!
All right, well then let's get to work.
I grabbed this piece from some built-in shelves we used to have and started by removing the screws. Except my screwdriver wouldn't fit them. So, I tried a smaller screwdriver. That's when I figured out they were nails. Probably should have put on my reading glasses first. I cut it down into workable lengths with my circular saw and then went over to the table saw sled so that I could square up the ends. After ripping everything down to the dimensions I needed, I came to a wonderful discovery. This is poplar. Maybe not everybody's favorite wood, but way better than what I had expected. I called Little Bit over to help me with the planer, and then our milling was done. Because our seat used two pieces instead of one, it made more sense to do this step now. Instead of having to drill and file and do all that stuff, we just cut it on the bandsaw, and this was Princess's first chance to ever cut a curve.
Wait, what's she doing here? I think she's playing a video game. Gosh, she's intense. Nope, it's a spindle sander. Now there's a lot of things I don't know about woodworking, but one thing I do know is if you want to keep kids interested, you've got to move quick. This is a shortcut to avoid setting up the router with a roundover bit. Now, I see this piece as a bit utilitarian, more than decorative at least. I wouldn't do this on a dining room table, but it works here. Next up was beveling the battens. Anyways.
When you chamfer the ends first, then any damage you do get will come off when you do the long edges. So always do the ends first.
Whoops. Okay, that makes sense.
All right, we've got the cutting done. Now what Rex does is uses screws to hold this together. We're not gonna do that. We're gonna use glue and we're gonna use the nail gun.
Yeah, nail gun.
Yeah, you've used it before. You never have.
Don't add it into the table.
I know, right? So here's a quick lesson.
We added some glue and then each of the girls got a turn with a nail gun. We thought this was a good idea at the time, but we quickly learned that it was gonna be a big mistake. See, the problem here was that some of those nails were in the same place we needed to drill holes for the legs. I tried everything I could think of. Tried to dig them out, I tried to pry them out. In the end, they mostly just broke. I considered just prying the battens off and making new ones, but then I remembered, I have a spade bit that I don't care about. Yeah, I just drilled through them and it worked. So Rex has this cool metal bevel gauge that he uses to set the 15 degree angle and just uses it as a guide to cut his holes. I don't have a bevel gauge, but I did have a piece of a 2x4, so I cut it to a 15 degree angle, and I think it kind of worked. I marked the center of the leg blanks and used the same spade bit to show me where the tenon was supposed to be. Would have been better to use a Forstner bit, but I have three of them and none of them were that size. I marked 2 inches from the end and then cut the shoulder using the table saw sled. Look, Rex uses power tools in this build too, so dadgummit, I'm gonna do it. And no, he doesn't want to take away your power tools. For anyone who thinks that the difference between me and a professional woodworker is just the tools that they have, watch how I make a mess of this. Ooh, don't do this between the legs thing. Thanks, Old Navy Jeans, for saving my femoral artery. So clearly I'm gonna have to do something to make up for the difference between Rex's skill level and mine. I went back to the table saw sled to at least try to take off the shoulder on the four sides, and then took it over to the drum sander to see if I could sort of freehand sand the rest down. As an added benefit, this added the little bevel thing at the end of the shoulder. I whittled to get it the rest of the way down, which is what I really should have done from the first, because the grain of the wood isn't exactly straight, and that's what was causing me trouble with the chisels. There's nothing like whittling under a big tree on a nice day, too. So this little trick involves taking a piece of scrap wood and drilling a hole in it the same size as your tenon's supposed to be, and that way you can shove it in there and see how you're doing. These legs are beveled and turned into a kind of octagonal shape. Now you're supposed to do this with a hand plane and, well, I did one of them that way. I had this crazy idea for tapering the legs on the jointer by putting a wooden ruler under the back end of the leg to sort of simulate that bevel. Would I recommend this for you? Oh heck no. I don't want to be responsible for your injury for doing this stupid stuff, but it worked for me. I made a jig to support the leg while we shaped it into an octagon. Octagon. Despite not having a real joiner's bench yet, I wanted to give the girls every opportunity to be successful in working with hand planes. Most woodworkers will never learn how to use them, sadly, and I think that they are wonderful tools, despite the fact that I may not be very good with them. Each of the girls got a chance to work with the number 4 plane and with a small block plane. And they thought that the shavings looked like spaghetti, so shenanigans ensued. After doing one leg, they went inside to the air conditioning and left the rest for me. I'm so lucky. Shocker, Rex's legs fit perfectly into the holes. Mine did not. If something like this ever happens to you, a great trick is to use hidden wedges. So I cut the slots for the wedges, and then I cut wedges out of the same material. I put some glue on the wedges, shoved them down into the slots, and then after putting glue in the holes, we just banged them down in there. No one will ever see those wedges, or even know that they're in there, except for us and I guess you now. But they spread out the top of that tenon so that it fits perfectly. I know the angle of those legs looks bad, and yeah, what did you expect? But it's not as bad as it looks. So I did use Rex's trick where you attach a pencil to the top of a 2x4, and you can use that to measure the legs and make sure that they're all the same height. So it should, in theory, sit level on top of the ground. Then I cut it off using the handsaw, and wouldn't you know it, after all the stupid, I cut myself with a handsaw. Not with a power tool, the stinking handsaw! I covered the whole thing with a coat of boiled linseed oil. I know most people probably would have stained it, but for some reason, I just think the green works for this. And there it is. Have you ever seen a lovelier Moravian stool? Don't answer that.
All right, girls, what did we think of this project?
Hard.
What was hard about it?
When we had to use a nail gun.
Okay, well, what do you think you learned doing this project?
How to use a nail gun.
That's a good thing to know. What did you think?
Stool.
Okay, and there you have it, people. Well, I think that the stool looks pretty good. It's not quite as good as Rex's stool, but I think we can use it. And maybe in 100 years, people will look at it and go, well, at least he didn't use a 2x4.
So, is Rex Krueger out of touch? I don't think so. If you've watched him for as long as I have, then you've seen him develop as you've developed as a woodworker too. If you can't tell, I'm a big Rex Krueger fan. I've learned so much from him, and while our woodworking styles may be a little bit different, namely in that he makes things that are great and, well, you know, I love this guy. If you are not familiar with Rex Krueger, I encourage you to check him out. If you want to build this project, I'm going to link down to Rex Krueger's plans in the description of this video. I don't make anything off of it. It's just kind of a way of saying thanks to him for all the inspiration that he's given me and all of us through the years. We'll see you next time.